Thanks to our sponsor, dundeal.ie, we bring you Business Bites, the best bits of that great business show, served up in individual servings.
Dundeal Motors is home to Ireland's largest range of new and premium used cars. That's why you'll find cars from Audi and BMW dealerships on Dundeal. Are you looking for a 7-seater to accommodate your growing family? Maybe you're after a luxury saloon to make a statement. We have the car for you. You'll also find Ireland's largest range of electric cars to help you make the switch. Visit dundeal.ie today to start the search for your next car.
From episode 129, Gary Wickham, founder of MagrowTec, who once employed 3,000 people, on growing another successful business. Now, two key elements of a successful business are, one, identify a problem. Two, solve that problem. A company that I first came across, as I mentioned, at the Ploughing Championship, has a technology that has identified not one, but two problems. They are inefficient spraying of crops, and then, secondly, the sometimes dangerous drifting of the product that is being sprayed. After spending a very long time researching a solution and raising a chunk of cash, MagrowTec is bringing its problem solver to markets across the world. Its magnetic spraying technology helps farmers grow more by using less. Gary Wickham is the man behind MagrowTec, and I haven't met him for 7 years. So a very warm welcome to that great business show, Gary.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here, and sorry it took so long to actually meet you.
Where have you been for 7 years?
I think I can nearly have an American passport at this stage. I spend a lot of time in America, where, you know, the majority of our business is. So when you run a business and you're scaling the team, raising funds, building your manufacturing capacity, building out your commercial team, entrepreneurs, it's hands-on every day of the week, and there's no let-up. This is my second go at it, crack at it.
I'll get back to that in a second, but I just want to remind people that this is since, well, I mentioned 2016,
right.
So overnight success since 2016.
Yeah. I mean, we've been around for about 9 years. We spent 4 or 5 years developing the technology, and we basically saw this massive problem, huge problem to solve, and that is pesticide or crop protection waste. 70% of what we spray in this world, that's $40 billion of products, don't go near the weed or crop. They go into the environment through drifting or runoff.
Well, now, that is your sales pitch. We'll get back to that. At the moment, I think you are employing about 30-odd people. But once upon a time, you had, I had to double-check this, 3,000? Did you have 3,000 people working?
In this organization? In State City? We've about 5,000, I think, now.
When you were there?
Yeah, that would have been sort of number, operating in 15 cities, yeah.
You set up a very successful company, Stay City.
Yeah.
Apartments.
Yeah.
People will be very familiar with that brand.
Yeah.
But you gave it up for rock and roll.
Yeah, I did. So my background as a scientist, I'm a technology guy. Another guy and myself and his brother came together to set up Stay City in my home. We met every week for a year while I was currently doing my job as an MD in a pharmaceutical company. We saw this opportunity, a different way of coming at it. Never worked in hotels in our life. We figured out how the business operates, and we came up with a USP, you know, to drive business through our own portal rather than through third parties, and you get higher revenue, and you have an apartment instead of a hotel room, so the cost per person was lower. Very simple model, and I think now it's about 150 million revenue business with about 5,000 employees. And yeah, so I learned how hotels work. I cleaned apartments, I did reception, I did everything you needed to do so I could understand the business, and my co-founder came on board about 3 or 4 years later.
But I have to say this to you, you checked out.
I did. I did check out.
Why?
So basically, I mean, I'm a technology guy at heart. I saw this opportunity. I'd been working in Stay City for 10 years. It was becoming like a routine job, you know, managing lots of people, doing the same thing all the time. I wanted a new challenge. And basically, I saw this huge opportunity on the agricultural side using technology to gather innovation in the agricultural space.
Where did you get that idea? Because I'm listening to your accent, and that has not come off a farm.
It did actually come off a farm.
Did it really?
Yes, it did. So there's a bit of a story to this. So my brother, it's a funny story. My late brother was buying a house in Florida. And he ended up going to dinner with the realtor and her husband. And the husband's the best way to describe him. I'm actually going to meet him next week. He's in the late 80s. He was like the mad inventor in Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, the grandfather. And a lovely man. And basically, we keep in touch today. And basically, he started talking about the problem with pesticide waste over dinner with my brother. And at the back of that meeting, my brother put $50,000 into it. He convinced me to do the same a few weeks later, but I was too busy with Stay City. And then I said, look, there's a business opportunity there. There's a USP problem. And he came up with the original concept. Now, the technology is totally different to what it was then, but somebody needed to commercialize it. So myself and another guy called David Moore said, we'll take it on. And we set up a Nova UCD. And that's, you know, and I'm trying the office with my credit card, no salary for 2 years. And that's how the journey started.
And where is it now? Because you have raised a chunk of change, I think 25 odd million.
25 odd million, yeah.
And the technology that you're talking about is using magnets, I think. Yeah. Is that correct?
Yes.
And it's not been done elsewhere.
No. So our technology is patented. So basically, we've patented, we use FR Kelly in Dublin to patent our technology. We've patented all over the world in 85% of our addressable market. We've new patents and know-how coming based on what we've learned over the last few years. So in any IP strategy, you start with an inner core and you keep surrounding the core with new IP and patents and know-how to protect the shell. And that's what we have done with our research. And basically, once we got that out there, we built prototypes. We saw the market was ripe for disruption. We saw that 70% of crop protection products don't hit the target weed or crop, go into our environment. So we saw a big problem. We saw a USP. We saw a big market. And then once we built the prototype, we identified that we needed a science-based strategy to develop the technology, because a lot of people think magnetic treatment of fluid is witchcraft, snake oil. So because I'm a scientist, we come up with four pillars, an empirical or science-based, and we work with Amber, Trinity College Dublin. We work with experts in the magnetic treatment of materials. I just came from a meeting with them yesterday, actually. So we've been working with them for the last 4 years on the empirical side, our lab-based side. We set up our own cross-science team with a world-renowned crop scientist. That's got about 10 people now. We set up an applied science team. We have a chief scientific officer driving that. And then we got field data working with customers. And then once we got enough data, then we went out through channel partners so that we had consistent data coming from the four streams. And that's how we launched the technology.
So let's discuss the technology itself. What it does is it makes a drop teeny, am I right? And then using magnets, it sticks more. Is that correct?
So the biggest problem in that 70% waste is there's a compromise with every technology in the world between drift and coverage. So some technologies are not bad with coverage and deposition onto the weed or crop. And some are good at drift, but none are good at boat until now. And that's where the technology we developed solved the problem. So we basically pass the fluid through these static non-uniform magnetic fields, and we change the physical properties of the fluid. And by doing so, mainly the water, we end up with more of the right type of droplets. You don't get the two small droplets that go in the air, exodrift, or you don't get the bigger ones called endodrift that run off, splatter, and miss the crop or weed. And we dramatically stop runoff into our rivers and streams and airborne contaminant.
But some people are saying that it doesn't actually do what you claim. Is that right? Or there are skeptics.
Skeptics because, one, we don't have brand awareness. You know, we're building that out through strategic partners, technically and commercially, and getting users using it. But the farming community are very conservative as it is. And sometimes they don't even know they have a problem. So you have to show the problem. You have to build trust. And we've been out there on fields now for 4 or 5 years. Customers using our technology for 4 or 5 years. No maintenance, no call-outs. So you build our trust. And on the back of the work we did, now we have all the big guys that want to partner with us. So we're working with a lot of big players now to look at rolling our technology out on a large scale.
And are the pesticide manufacturers, are they on side? And I'll tell you why I'm thinking there. It's not in their interest that you could be doing something more efficiently.
Yeah. And it's an excellent question. And I get asked this all the time. But to put things in context, right? So the UN estimates that if we didn't have pesticides or crop protection products, as some people call them, we'd have 40 to 60% less food. Yet we have to grow the same amount of food over the next 40 years as in the last 10,000 years combined because of 2 billion more people coming. So we're going to need more of these products anyway. The issue is getting them on target. So there is the science of chemistry. We're the science of application. And those companies are not developing the products at the rate they used to, and more are being banned for different reasons. Legislation, the EU wants to cut their usage by half. So on one hand, we're saying to farmers grow more food, we're vilifying them, and we're not giving them the tools to feed the world. Right? They kept us fed during COVID. You know, with the emergency workers and other people, they were heroes in my eyes in terms of keeping us fed, despite all the challenges when, you know, their workers were sick, the supply chain issues and so on. So we've got to help farmers feed the world. But if they've less and less tools, and the chemical companies spend about $250 million to develop a new product, it takes 13 years on average to develop, and 1 in 10 chances of succeeding. The odds are very, very low in terms of the success. So what we've got to try and do is get what we have on target, and that the farmers have the tools to deliver the efficacy against disease control, minimize runoff, and then everybody will be happy. We create a win-win. Farmers are spending less. There's less waste in the environment. The consumers are happy. And then the chemical companies are getting their products on target because, like us and antibiotics, weeds and crops become resistant to these products. So everybody has these challenges. So your question is valid. I would have said 10 years ago, they would have been looking me up and trying to find out how they could discredit me. And there's probably some of that still going on. But now I think they see us as a solution because we have this massive challenge and it's going to take everything in the book to solve it.
Call me skeptical, call me cynical, call me anytime you want. No. But would it not make more sense for the chemical companies just to come and buy you?
Yeah.
You've got your patent protection, just buy the guy.
Yeah, and again, an excellent question. You know, you must be reading my book, but one of them actually wanted to buy us and take us off the market a few years ago. And so we're not going to do that, right? I mean, we've technology for small farm holders. There's 500 million in the world. You know, we've proven we can drive their yield up to 300% is what the world needs to do using half the chemical and the water. So we want to drive this onto every farm in the world. And we want small farm holders in particular to have this technology and support the sustainable intensification of global food production. So we are not going to, you know, sell out, or we're not going to side with one particular player in the market. If we do that, it won't get on every farm.
If the checkbook is big enough, or if the check itself is big enough, you're for sale. Come on.
We have an emerging nanotechnology, which is very exciting in the ag and non-ag space in terms of what we're doing with the droplets that could be used in multiple areas. So what we want to do is look for partners that are willing to invest and drive other product lines.
And Gary, we were just talking there about other nanotechnology applications that you may have tucked up, hidden up your sleeve. What are you going to do?
Yeah, so we have a core magnetic assist technology, and we have a product. Our core product is the tractor boom product. We've developed one for greenhouses. We've got the small farm holder product. Again, I mentioned greatly reducing the chemical water use and labor required to drive yield in Africa and everything. That's what we need to do. We need to increase yield all over the world if we're going to meet these targets. Behind the scenes, we're going to be developing products for the Gulf market, air blast for the grape industry, nuts and so on. And we're also looking at spinning out divisions around irrigation based on work we've done to show early stage research that shows that we reduce water needed by 34% in work we did with USDA in America. And basically what we want to do now is do a full-scale commercial validation of that and then look at maybe licensing that technology, that if we can say that you need a third less water for irrigation, it's a game changer, you know, to help farmers.
That would be massive.
Yeah. So what we've got to do now is do large-scale commercial trials to validate what we saw at an empirical level.
I think you said that you've been at this for 9 years.
Yeah, I mean,
we spent... How do you get out of bed? I mean, you were successful with State City.
Yeah.
And now, like, as I say, it goes back 7 years since I met you.
Yeah.
And I was always chasing you to find out what was happening next. I love the story when I met you back then.
Yeah.
How do you get out of bed all the time? Because, you know, you're still climbing that ladder.
Yeah, no, it's difficult sometimes. I mean, there's times where you're kind of wondering where the money comes to pay people, typical entrepreneur stuff, you know, even though I've done it before. We've overcome all those challenges. I've got great backers, a great board that backs me. I get out of bed every day because we know air technology, you know, uses no energy. It doesn't consume anything once you install it. So we're doing exactly what the world needs to do, which is using less to do more. And if we're going to have a small part in solving this great food and water challenge the world is facing, that gets me up out of bed every day, and that gets the team up out of bed every day. And we've new technologies and products coming that are even better. And so I just look and see these massive opportunities and problems to solve. And I'm more excited than even when you met me four or five years ago.
7 years ago.
Is it 7 years ago?
Seven years ago. But like at some stage you have to say, come on, look, I've got another life to live. Something else to do, no?
We've got this big pipeline. We're in a great phase now. We've got some great partners we're working on that will be announced in the near future. Very exciting.
You can announce them now if you want.
We've got some, like, you know, in Vivo in France we're working with. We're working with some OEMs, one of the biggest OEMs in the world that makes sprayers. We're working with biologic companies. Biologics is interesting. So you have conventional chemistry, which is your petrochemical-based conventional pesticides. They're the majority of the market. People are trying to bring biologic products that are safer to use. The problem is, like organics, is they need a much higher dose transfer because of their lower toxicity. And I'm actually going to be in Florida next week meeting customers that have switched to our technology because they can't achieve what they need to do with organics, but they're getting with our technology. And we have customers that are getting better performance with biologics with our technology together. And actually, we're just about to enter a partnership with a biologics with their what's called adjuvant technology and theirs together in harness, solving the problem. So I'm really excited about what's coming.
So where are you going? Are you going to raise more money? Do you need more money? What do you need next?
You're constantly raising money because organic growth is going to be too slow to have first mover advantage, even with IP. And we want to strengthen the team continuously. We want to accelerate existing products in existing markets and enter new markets. It takes about $1 million to go into a new market with our existing products, you know, with marketing and other things and manufacturing costs. So you need money all the time to accelerate what you have. And we are bubbling behind the scenes. We've got these new technologies and you've got to keep nurturing them. So on one hand, you're accelerating what you have. And on the other hand, you're nurturing the new products and technologies behind the scenes.
So how much more do you need to raise?
So we're currently doing a round of about 10 million. And then beyond that, we're just completing our strategic plan, which identifies how we're going to bring those products and technologies to market, the team to deliver, the funding needed. And we reckon we're probably going to raise 30 to 40 million in the next 18 to 24 months to drive that plan.
Now, you have been around the block, as I mentioned, a few times there. Yeah. So you do know what's ahead of you. And you also kind of have a plan, I'd say. You're lying in bed thinking. So what is that plan?
Yeah, so I kind of touched on it there. This strategic plan is kind of, we now know by looking at the market size, competitive analysis, financial due diligence, the ROI for the customer, ROI, how we're going to make the products in the business model, how we're going to bring these products in order. We now know what funding we need. We know how we're going to execute. We know the team that's needed. So now that plan has just been finished. We're now going to carry out all the actions within that plan. The good thing is that I involved the whole team and the board at the beginning. So I now have everybody on the same train, on the same track, going to the same destination. So we all know where we're going, which is critical.
You're HQ'd in Dublin, Ireland, as I heard you saying on a podcast earlier. Yeah. Would you locate elsewhere? Say in the States now, if you are manufacturing, where will you manufacture?
So currently we do third-party manufacturing. We invest in the molds. It keeps your costs down. We have a team called business and risk management. So I look at everything from currency risk, supplier risk, you know, geopolitical risk. And so thankfully during COVID.
Cut across there. Who does that for you? You're not sitting there doing it yourself.
I do it with the team, with the executive team. Yeah, we work on it together. I would have done this stuff before. So not every company does it, but they should. Even down to what if there was a fire in the office, something happened to me, God forbid. But looking at how the business can continue to run in all scenarios. And looking at, you know, we even looked at virus risk. It was on one of my slides going back a couple of years ago and they laughed at me, you know, and said, why? And I didn't know COVID was coming, but anything can happen, right? And so we could have a war, we've seen it, we could have, that could develop further. So you're constantly looking, but on the manufacturing, we brought in enough manufacturing plants in Italy, France, and the UK. And when COVID started, we were able to swap from one to the other. And now we're looking at bringing one up in running in the US. But we just make the mold. We control the quality, which is really important. Never give away our quality. So we want to make sure we're ISO approved as well, that we control our quality standards. So whether we license or JV or direct manufacture, that's critical.
And what is the dream there? Or maybe even an IPO?
Yeah, so I had a call last night with a US gentleman and we're looking at a roadmap for possible, you know, partnership IPO type events. But you need to start looking at that now. And that could be 3 years out.
Okay, but that's still pretty exciting.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. The good thing about this is that I've never seen a technology that has so many opportunities across the food and water space and even into other industrial areas. Potentially, our technology could be used in the medical space down the line. So the list is endless. It's how you bring those on stream. And once, you know, we get people all the time saying, tell me how your technology works, you know. And the question, of course, is who wants to know? And why do you want to know? You need to answer that question first because of IP protection. You can get into NDAs, but you have to be really careful with your IP. But then when you get beyond that and you've got the right partners and brand awareness, people don't ask you about your technology. They ask you, what else do you have? It's a different...
It's funny, when I was looking this up, I was thinking, I wonder what else they could do with that. So I suppose I must have gone past the NDA part. Tell us the honest truth now. Has anybody any of your wannabe partners tried to nick your IP, or has anybody tried to do anything naughty on you?
No. Again, one of my strategies early on was try to get people into NDA, including the big guys. So actually go to them and say, you need to talk to us, knowing that they're very slow, the big guys. There's a certain point where that changes. And we got them all into NDA. It was kind of a tactic on my part. So I have what's called an IP strategy rather than a patent strategy. I hear people talking about patents, but it should be IP. That means patents, know-how, new patents, collaborations with strong partners on the commercial and technical side so you can defend yourself, and good IP lawyers as well. So once you have that in place, you're fully protected and people are less likely to copy you. Equally, you know, in Asia, right, it's well known that certain things can get copied in certain territories. So we didn't go there, and we'll only go there with the right partner. And also, we don't do the manufacturing in that part of the world. We do parts of it. So you never finish it there, whatever you do. That's something I learned over the years as well. And I think we're at the point where these big partners want to work with us rather than copy us, because there's too many challenges if they do. Now, saying that, there is one OEM that has been testing our technology in secret for 2 years, and we found out. But we confronted that.
How did you do that? And how did you find out?
I can't reveal my sources. I'm like a good journalist here. So, but basically,
but you find out that somebody's doing something very, very naughty for 2 years.
Yeah, but we had them under NDA. I can safely say, thankfully, the results were very good. So we actually turned it on its head. We actually went to them and said, well, look, we think this is going on. Why don't you work with us?
Well, what was the phone call? I mean, I presume it was a phone call. Did you phone up the CEO and say, come here to me? Yeah. We're hearing things.
We sent a gentle little email and said, you know, and you phrase it in a certain way, in the sense that, look, why don't we work together in solving your problem? And that worked. So I think there's an approach, and you have to be, you know, your tactics have to be spot on in terms of how you approach these guys so they don't shut the door. You're better off working with them than against them. They're too big.
And they could squish you.
They could.
Which neatly brings me to the other part, which I'm always interested in, but patent protection and or, you know, the wider thing. Enforceability. And you see the Samsungs and the Googles and the Apples.
Yeah.
I mean, they've got billions, zillions that they can throw at this stuff. Yeah. You haven't.
We don't. And look, you know, it could take you millions to chase a patent. I mean, you've probably heard the story about Polaroid and Kodak, you know, and, you know, I think it was Polaroid, Kodak copied them, and Polaroid took them to court, took 10 years, right? And in the meantime, Kodak made a ton of money, right? So that's the world. So again, I'm happy with our NDAs, and I'm happy with our strategic partners that we're working with across the different spaces, OEMs, chemicals, biologics, in the food chain, big growers as well, big growers that I'm talking 10 billion revenue, who of the order of 10 billion revenue, are trying to push technology like ours into the growers' hands. And so, again, I think everybody's beginning to look at sustainability. Some are serious and some are, there's a lot of greenwashing, right? I mean, it's something that gets my back up, the greenwashing that's going on there. The EU are trying to do something about it. But the good guys are going to come true, because the others are going to be found out. And so we're trying to partner ourselves with the good guys, that we can say, we are trying to do this for the right reasons, and we have the solution that's going to create this win-win. Everything in life is a bit of win-win. So every negotiation discussion I go in is try to find that win-win. You know, how can I get them to feel they want to do a deal with us? And I think everything in life is about creating that win-win.
And anything that can also cut water usage, because water is going to be the big issue in 10 or 20 years' time.
Yeah.
Final question we ask everybody on the show. Mm. Who would you hire in a heartbeat?
Yeah. Am I allowed to mention two or three?
You may, as you can have the entire team.
Yeah, yeah. So I probably name a lot of my team, you know, but I won't. I mean, I've got a great team. So, you know, I do have to throw that in there. I have a wonderful team that has got us to where we are today. But there's a couple of people. And one of them is Bill Gates. You know, not everybody's a fan. I think, you know, I look at the guy and go, he's built an incredible technology. He's an entrepreneur. You know, his technology, his company's technology is probably in every computer in the world. On the other hand, he's agreed to donate.
Pretty bad technology, though.
Whatever your opinion
junky.
Is.
Yeah, it's horrible. Yeah.
Probably, you know, and people have different views. But, I mean, it was a revolution at its time.
Absolutely,
for his time.
Absolutely.
But he, rightly or wrongly, he's donating most of his wealth to philanthropic purposes, you know, to clean sanitation for third world countries, clean water, and now the vaccine program and others. You know, so I think he'll actually, his legacy will be probably his philanthropic work that he's done rather than what he's done at Microsoft in due course. And that's not bad. You
that's
know,
not
you
bad, think yeah.
The other guy is probably Warren Buffett. Two people I constantly mention. You know, he's an 88-year-old, I think. Still drives the same car, as humble as you can get. Still, you ask me about passion, how do I still go? He's 88 and still going, right? And he's a guy I look up to. One of the best investors in the world. He's given most of his wealth away, you know. And you know, I look to those guys and go, wow, you know, we can give out about them. But that's, I think that's something special, right? And then the other person is a lady called, you probably should get her in here if you haven't, Faye Walsh Drouillard. She has founded a company called Wake Up Capital.
I haven't.
Yeah, American lady. He lives in Ireland. And they're a seed investor in their company, and I should declare that, you know. And she is an observer on our board and a very impressive lady. And she's on the speaking circuit, you know, talking about supporting sustainability. But the difference about someone like Wake Up Capital and Faye is that they mean it. I can safely say they really are concerned about driving sustainability. So I would say they're not one of these people that greenwash, that's for sure. The other thing is that she has this mission to support female entrepreneurs, which, you know, I love. Funny enough, their first company to invest in was us. But she's a great person. I really admire her. And she's way above where we are. But I mean, if I could employ her, I would. So she's a lady you should get around someone someday.
If you organise that for me, but please,
I will.
Do not leave it for 7 years like the last time.
Yeah, I won't. I promise I won't. Yeah.
Faye, we would love to have you in here. Yeah. That sounds like a wonderful opportunity for us. Gary Wickham, founder of MagrowTec. Thank you so much for joining us on That Great Business Show.
Want to increase sales, reduce overheads, and provide customers with a better service? Then use Big Red Web, the easiest way to develop and maintain your website. It gives you powerful business reporting, digital marketing, and automatically integrates with the award-winning Big Red Cloud Accounting software. It's a game changer for SME businesses. It's so good, the government gives you a €2,500 grant towards it. Big Red Web, e-commerce made simple. BigRedCloud.com/web.
De facto shaving oil, made only from natural oils. Nothing nasty on your skin.
This interview was first posted on episode 129 of That Great Business Show, Essential Listening for Every Business. For more great business insights, listen to our entire back catalogue of That Great Business Show on Spotify or